Hello and welcome to a new IFIMAC plus ICMM seminar. Today, from the Institute of Material Science in Madrid, I am María José Calderón and I will be chairing the seminar today. For those who are online, if you have any questions, use the chat to write them, or at the end of the seminar, raise your hand and we will open the mics for you. So now it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Gloria Platero. She's a research professor here at the Institute, and she's the leader of the group New Platforms and Nanodevices for Quantum Simulation and Quantum Computation. After a postdoc in Grenoble, she got tenure at the CSIC, and later she has moved a lot around the world, invited in different institutions at universities in Hamburg, Stuttgart, Berlin, Aalto and Ottawa, to name a few. Recently, she has been Mercator Fellow at the University of Regensburg, and she's currently the secretary of the IUPAP C8 Commission for Semiconductor Physics. Her research areas are in the field of quantum nanoscience, in particular quantum transport in semiconductor nanostructures and on spin qubits on quantum dot arrays. She also investigates the electronic, dynamical, and transport properties of time periodic driven systems. And recently, she also works in low dimensional topological systems and on the role of edge states for quantum state transfer. So today, she's going to tell us about a simulation of topological phases in quantum dot arrays. So please, the floor is yours.
Okay, so thank you very much, Maria Jose. Sorry, I'm going to take out the mask. And first I want to thank the organizers for giving me the possibility to participate in this joint seminar series, ICMM, the Material Science Institute of Madrid at the Spanish Research Council, where I work, and also the IFIMAC is an excellent center at the Autonomous University of Madrid on condensed matter physics. So the title of my talk is Simulation of Topological Phases in Driven Quantum Dot Arrays. But my aim, sorry, it is blocked the pointer. Okay, sorry. So the aim of my talk, in fact, today is to speak about semiconductor quantum dot arrays. And also I want to speak about flocke engineering, in particular, how one can simulate in one dimensional systems topology, and in particular in semiconductor quantum dot arrays. And what I want is really give you an overview first of the state of the art of semiconductor quantum dot arrays for two purposes. One is quantum state transfer, and then also for quantum simulation. And then at the end, I will focus on this particular driving protocol that we propose in order to imprint non-trivial topology in a semiconductor quantum dot array. So concerning quantum state transfer, I want to cite this famous work, which is done in another different platform, which is the work by Sirac, Soler, and co-workers, where they proposed many years ago that one can transfer one state, which is in an atom, which is a three-level atom, which is plugged in an optical cavity. One can transfer this state to another atom, which is far apart, also is plugged in a quantum cavity, and then the photons are the transmission particles which transmit the states of this state of this atom to this other one. So from this time, then some years later, in another theoretical paper, Stays, Barnes, and Milburg propose how to bring these ideas in a solid state platform, in particular in quantum dots. And then also what they propose is to use a topological H states, in this case, a quantum Hall H state, to bring the information. So in this case, they prepare one state in one quantum dot, and they want to transfer this state to this other quantum dot by means of electrons, now are the carrier particles, which propagate through a quantum Hall H states, which they can propagate in one direction. Okay, so from this time up to now, this type of hybrid systems has been very much studied and investigated, in particular in quantum dots. In semiconductor quantum dots, there are different qubits which can be implemented, but the spin qubits are the most popular ones because they are robust against the coherence and relaxation. So there are many works concerning the interaction of semiconductor qubits in quantum dots with cavities, but only recently they were able to implement a coherent spin photon interface when just one spin of the electron is coupled to the cavity. The problem is that this spin has a very small magnetic moment, and then it was difficult to consider or achieve a strong coupling. And then what they do is to use electron-dipole interaction plus hybridization of the charge and the spin. And what they do is to employ gradients of magnetic fields or spin orbit interaction. I tell you that because also there are many works on that, and they have also achieved in a recent paper to make interact spin qubits in a double quantum dot, which is in a position to another one, which is very far apart using a superconducting cavity. So looking at the transmission of the cavity, they saw the interaction between the spins. But okay, there are other ways, other hybrid systems where one can transfer in quantum dots, charge, spin, and quantum states. Like for instance, using surface acoustic waves. But I want to speak about quantum dot arrays. So doing a bit story about this topic, many years ago, Loss and DiVincenzo in the late 90s proposed to use semiconductor quantum dots for the quantum computer. And then they, of course, there were some requirements concerning qubit operations, one qubit and two qubit operations in order to implement a quantum gate. Also, there were other conditions like reduce the decoherence and also scalability. But in the next 10 years, all the work was devoted to study in double quantum dots these one qubit operations. They studied the coherent rotation of one spin with electron spin resonance or electron dipole spin resonance, and also operations with two qubits. And then for that, they use a change interaction and swapping. But and also they study the coherence, which was mainly produced by hyperfine interaction because at these days the semiconductor use was gallium arsenide. And then the hyperfine interaction between the nuclear spins and the spin of the electrons was quite important. But just 10 years later, one did a step further in the direction of scalability and also to have more complex physics. And then triple quantum dots were implemented in this triangular configuration, for instance. It is built up in the group of Rolf Hauging in Hannover, where one can have also interactions between the path and interferences, and also new physics has been investigated. And this a triple quantum dot in linear configuration, this has been fabricated in the group of Andy Sakraida in Ottawa, where you can have also new physics because now you have two dots which are not directly coupled, and then you can have long range interactions, you can have long range transfer of information, and so on. But one had to wait yet some years just to achieve I would say, longer array of quantum dots. And this is a very nice achievement in 2016 is a long array of quantum dots in silicon. They are up to 9 quantum dots. And then what is very interesting is that at this time and in the next years, the experimentalists were able to control many issues which had avoided to manipulate these quantum dot systems for quantum information, quantum computation purposes. For instance, they had problems because they had capacitive cross-talking, a barrier disorder to fill up each dot independently. All of these issues were investigated and were overcome. So I go to triple quantum dots again, doing the story. And I mention these experiments because I think that they are a breakthrough in this transfer of quantum states. And where the experiments done by Andy Sakraida in NRC in Ottawa, where they saw some unexpected lines in the transport picture, in the transport experiments. So these lines correspond to processes like this one, where when you have, for instance, two electrons in the left dot, zero in the center, and one in the right, you can transfer directly this two electron state to the right without the participation of the intermediate configuration, which was far apart the tune. So this is motivated, or is due to quantum coherence and where a coherent superposition is formed. They have analyzed this property in different regions in the stability diagram, And they have seen that, in fact, what they propose is that if you prepare a quantum state like this, and then what can happen is that this state can be transferred from the right to the left, and the particle which transfers the state is a spin which acts as a spin bus. Then concerning quantum dots, triple quantum dots again, and doing the story of the field, I just want to mention these experiments by van der Siepen, where they consider a closed system. They study the transfer of charge in this case. So they demonstrate also that one can transfer directly one state where one has one electron in the left, one in the center, and zero in the right to this other state, where you have zero electrons in the left and one in the center and one in the right directly, but in this case with the help of photons. So what they do is to drive the system, and then by means of photon-assisted tunneling, they have what is called long-range photon-assisted tunneling. And this work was also afterwards I would say, system investigated in other papers, in other works. And also recently it was proposed that if you have a triple quantum dot with two spins, then you can prepare an arbitrary quantum state in the Bloch sphere, yeah, and you can transfer this quantum state from the left to the right just by applying magnetic field gradients and also AC driving. And with the AC driving, what you can do is to stop the evolution producing destructive interferences. And then you can also, by means of these photosite bands, which appear in the photo-assisted tunneling, you can transfer the state directly from one edge to the other one of the structure. So again, speaking about state transfer, quantum state transfer, I want to mention this very well-known protocol, but for those who are not familiarized, I want to mention the adiabatic protocols, and that is the most popular one, which is called coherent transfer by adiabatic passage, and it was proposed by Andrew Greentree many years ago. So it consists, it's very simple, it consists in having a triple quantum dot or a triple quantum well with levels aligned, levels in resonance, and if you have one particle here, what you do is to apply pulses in an adiabatic manner to these barriers, and then you are able to transfer directly the one electron, which is in the left quantum dot, to the right quantum dot. Here are the occupations when you change the ratio between the pulses. So that is because also superposition is formed and you can change these amplitudes. But what happens is that these processes are prone to decoherence because they are adiabatic. So here, okay, in this paper, Sigmund Koller and co-workers show that if you put contacts, you can also measure the fidelity of this protocol, but looking to soft noise and current. Well, and now following, when one has also longer or larger structures, it was proposed that you can transfer, in fact, with this CTAP protocol, not only one particle, but also two entangled spins from one region of a quantum dot array to the left directly to the other region to the right. But what is more interesting is that, as I have said, these adiabatic protocols are prone to decoherence. So then what were implemented are techniques which are called shortcuts to adiabaticity protocols. There are different protocols with these shortcuts to adiabaticity, but the idea is that what you do is to speed up the adiabatic protocol. So what you do is to design in an efficient way pulses, and then you go faster in regions where you can go faster, for instance, far for the anti-crossings, and then you reduce the speed, and you can really improve a lot the velocity, the speed of the protocol, and therefore also the fidelity of these protocols. Okay, in all of these works, okay, I also want to mention the work of David Fernandez, who is now extending these ideas also to another very interesting spin qubits in quantum dots, which are Hall spin qubits, because now they are very popular, because with Hall spin qubits in the valence band, what happens is that the shape of the wave function, which is p-type, makes that the interaction with nuclear spins is very small. So therefore, even if you work in gallium arsenide, which has a strong hyperfine interaction, it is very useful. And also, they have inherent spin orbiting, and then one can do operations very fast. So then also here it has been shown that one can also have this, apply these protocols where spin orbit is important, and one can even control the polarization of the spin, controlling the parameters of the system. Okay, all of these protocols that I have mentioned imply the shuttling of particles, the shuttling of charge or spins, and there are many experiments also in the group of van der Siepen, for instance, in Delft, or in also in Tarucha's group in Tokyo, and in other, also in Princeton, in the group of PETA. Okay, just to finish with the state of the art of this, I would say, long arrays and quantum transfer, there are many different examples. For instance, in this work, what they don't do is to move physically the spins or the charge. They just, by means of a change interaction and also by adiabatic protocols, they are able to change the spin, sorry, the state of one spin, but without moving the spin physically. And also there are other protocols which use this floquet, which is this periodic driving, as I will explain in a moment, and for enhancing the spin swaps. And there are many papers, also this is a theoretical one by the group of PETA, where they use also this CTAP, but with many electrons and magnetic field gradients. Okay, but now what I will go is to the second part, where that is to motivate why these systems can be used as quantum simulators. And then I think that the first example, which is, I think, very important one, it was done many years ago again. Well, I will go now to that. But before, I want to show you that here one has achieved recently also this sort of long arrays, and also even two-dimensional arrays. This is with the MOS techniques in Grenoble, where they have done a 4x2 array, or also, for instance, here, when one has a 3x3 array of quantum dots. Also, this is a work from Grenoble. And then if one looks at this, one can think that it is possible to simulate complex Hamiltonians with quantum dot arrays, but one thinks, is it possible also to simulate complex lattices, because you have here quite long arrays. So I just want to show some examples. And then I think that the most important is, the first important simulation with quantum dots is to simulate condo physics. And it was proposed many years ago, also at the late 90s, in the group of Delft, by Leo Kamenhofen and also Goldhaber Gordon, who was at this time, I think, in MIT. And they saw the condo physics in one quantum dot, and afterwards also in two quantum dots, and also three quantum dots. And then there are a lot of works now working on this and studying this complex physics, even combining quantum dots, semiconductor quantum dots, with superconducting contacts and studying the interplay between superconductivity and condo and so on. So I think that it is the first example, even if we didn't speak at this time about quantum simulations. Also, there are some work, theoretical work, where one study the Wigner molecule, so in two dimensions. And then recently, this is this experimental work by the group of also of Delft, van der Siepen, where what they do is to investigate Nagaoka ferromagnetism, which has been observed in an array, in this case, of four quantum dots, forming a closed loop configuration, a square configuration. Then I mention other works, like, for instance, this work when they propose how to simulate in a long array of quantum dots the Fermi-Havard model, and also the antiferromagnetic Heisenberg change. It is a recent work by the group of Delft as well. But also I have seen this very nice preprint the other day, where what they have are not these quantum dots I am speaking, but they have donors in silicon, donor atoms. And then they propose now to simulate an extended Fermi-Havard model in two dimensions, and they use the STM technique in order to manipulate the different hoppings and the positions of the atoms and so on. So I think that this platform of real atoms in also in a semiconductor can be very, I would say, promising. Well, now I come to what we have simulated. And first, I'm going to tell the simplest topological model that those who are familiarized know very well in one dimension. This simple topological model is the SSH model, or the Schuh-Schriffer-Hegger model. And it corresponds to a change of dimer, so diatomic molecules, which are coupled, they have a coupling in intra-dimer cell and also an inter-dimer hopping. This model is a time-binding Hamiltonian at first order with first order neighbors, and also is a single particle Hamiltonian. So as you see, it's very simple Hamiltonian. So if one now considers not an infinite array, a periodic array, but one considers a finite array, for instance, here we consider 10 dimers, 20 atoms, then what one sees is that you plot the energy spectrum of the system as a function of the ratio between these two hoppings, the intra-dimer hopping and the inter-dimer hopping, you see that initially below around one, you have a gap here. And then when you increase this ratio up to around one, then a transition happens. And then there are two states which merge, which appear, come from the bulk, which are degenerating energy, not strictly because they are slightly splitted due to the finite length of the sample, and appear at zero energy. And then these are called H states. Why? Because they have a spectral density, they have weight at the edges of the structure. So one can then study the topological invariant of this system. And as you know, this topological invariant is the winding number that you can calculate in the bulk. And then it corresponds to a very phase, which is picked up by a particle, which moves across the Brillouin zone. So this winding number has been measured already in cold atoms by the group of Immanuel Bloch in 2013. And then what happens is that in this region is topologically trivial. You have a winding number equal to zero. But in this other region, the winding number is one. And then it means that you have here one pair of topologically protected H states. In this system, the system is classified in the BDI class, in this Adland-Simbauer classification. And you have a particle hole, time reversal, and also chiral symmetry. So what is important to say is that these H states, which are here in the middle of the gap, then are topologically protected. And what does it mean? It means that they are protected against off-diagonal hopping fluctuations. So they are protected against the tunneling fluctuations. So this could be a very interesting setup to transfer information because of their robustness. So then you could say me, okay, if you have now this very long array of quantum dots, why not to implement directly with by electrostatic means this alternating hopping? So you can put a TT prime, TT prime with electrostatic gates, and then you would have your dimer exchange. And the answer is yes, you can do that. But in reality, what happens is that one has not only first order neighbors in the real life in different systems, but also you can have also longer order range of hoppings. And then what does it mean? It means that from all these hoppings that you can have, there are hoppings which destroy the topology. And then what we want is to get rid of them. And then our idea is not to simulate the SSH Hamiltonian, but the extended version, which includes all the possible order hoppings, long range order hoppings. So let us look at them in detail, how they fulfill. But before, I just want to speak of Floquet theory, two words for those who didn't hear about that before, because we are going to use a driving protocol, which now is called Floquet engineering. And then just to mention for those who didn't hear about Floquet, Floquet theory is analog to Bloch theory, but in the time domain. So you have a Hamiltonian, which is periodic in time instead of in space. And then you have solutions to the Schrödinger equation, which have two terms here. One is the Floquet states, which are similar to the Bloch states, but periodic in time. They have the periodicity of the driving. And also you have here these quasi-energies, which are defined also in the Floquet-Brillouin zone. and are equivalent to the quasi-momenta in the Bloch theory. And then you can obtain the Floch equation just by applying the Schrödinger equation. And then I want to mention that, of course, if you have both time periodicity and spatial periodicity, also it has been developed a theory, which is Floch-Bloch theory, to treat the both periodicities at the same time. So now for motivation of Floch driving, I want to use this example, which again is a very old experiment, but I think it's one of the first on photo-assisted tunneling. I like it very much. It was done in Delft also at this time, Leo Kamenhofen, and then they had a diatomic molecule, a double quantum dot, and they apply an AC driving. And then what they saw, as expected, now that you know that, is if you look at the transport, you see a main peak where these levels are in resonance, and also you see satellites when the detuning between the levels is a multiple of the frequency of the driving. Then what is interesting here and why the Floch engineering is very popular is because that is not the only thing you do, but also you renormalize the tunneling, you renormalize the hopping, or in other words, you renormalize the bond between the atoms. And then even for certain parameters of the intensity and frequency, you even can renormalize the hopping to zero. So you can induce localization with the AC driving. So as you renormalize the hopping, you can modify the electronic, the topological, the dynamical properties of the systems. And here I put some examples. For instance, in the hexagonal lattice, you can apply a driving field, and then you can see how you can see the merging of the Dirac cones in this hexagonal lattice. Or you can also modify the dynamics of particles like this, which are doublons, strongly interacting particles, which propagate together in a lattice. This is a Lib lattice. And then one can see an exotic dynamics, the sublattice dynamics induced by the AC field. Other thing that you can do is to modify the topological phases of systems like this one, the SSH Hamiltonian, applying, for instance, a sinusoidal driving. You can modify the topological phases. I'll speak to that in a second. And also even you can, that is a recent work by Jordi Pico, you can even try to reduce the charge noise in qubits, in spin qubits, in double quantum dots, by inducing what are called sweet spots, so regions where the charge noise is reduced, but inducing them dynamically, so applying an AC field. So you can do, and there are many other examples, especially in topological systems. But okay, now just two words about this, the real dimer change here with the real SSH Hamiltonian, I want to say, where when we analyze the topological phases and you plot the topological phases when you drive the system as a function of the parameters of the driving and of the parameters of the sample, here is the intradimer distance. So what you see is that before driving, we have seen that we can have two invariants, two topological invariants, the winding number equal to zero, which corresponds to trivial phase, or equal to one, which corresponds to the topological non-trivial phase. But now what we see is that when we have the condition where we would expect a trivial topology, we have regions here in blue, for instance, in the picture to the left, we have regions where the topology is not trivial, the blue regions, or the other way around. When we have a condition where we expect that all the phase diagram would be non-trivial, we have also regions where the topology is trivial. So you can manipulate the phase diagram of your system by applying the topological phase diagrams by applying AC driving. And also, I would like to mention that, okay, is it possible to measure or to detect these topological phases? This is a work with Monica Benito and Sigmund Koller, where what it was studied is that how is the transport in a dimer change? We had just one electron and considered a strong interaction, so that cannot be a second particle here. And then we apply also an AC driving to the system. And then it was interesting to see that if we plot these quasi energies, which are here, is it? Sorry, I don't see the pointer, but When we plot the quasi energies, we see regions where we have these H states, which are non-trivial, topologically speaking, these regions with H states, and they correspond to a current, the blocking of the current, which is called H blockade, topological H blockade. So that is because the particle drops in these H states, which are separated from the bulk, and then the current decreases strongly. Okay, no, it's the laser, doesn't work. Okay, but then what we have seen also even further is that if you study the noise, then what you can see is that you can reproduce this picture that I showed you in the previous slide of the winding number or tag phase. We can reproduce it just plotting the soft noise as a function of the same parameters. So it means that also transport can be a good tool to detect the topological phases of a system. So now I'll go to the extended SSH Hamiltonian. So we are going to divide the analysis in even order hoppings and also in odd order hoppings. Even order hoppings are those which connect atoms of the same type, and of odd order hoppings are those which connect different atoms. When you consider even neighbor hoppings, what happens is that the chiral symmetry, which is a key symmetry in this system, is broken. So what happens is that now this topology is destroyed. We can have yet some H states, but they are not topologically protected. And then we have, I show you here the energy as a function of the parameter, the second order hopping parameter, when we consider a lattice where we have just first order neighbors and second order neighbors. So increasing the hopping, the second order works, increasing the second order hopping. So what we see is that this H state, just these H states, they drop, they are not symmetric in energy. They drop linearly with the hopping, and also they just for large enough second order hopping, they just go to the bulk. There is a transition to a metallic phase. So we want to get rid of this even order hoppings. It would be also if we would consider four order hoppings would happen similar things. What happens now with odd order hoppings? With odd order hoppings, we are safe because the chiral symmetry is preserved. But furthermore, it is very interesting to have these odd order hoppings because now we can have also more topological phases. So it means that now we have this topological number, this winding number, which is can be not only zero or one. One corresponded, as you remember, to one pair of H states because of the bulk boundary correspondence, but also we can have three pairs of H states. So that is also something that also is interesting because maybe one can play with all these H states, as I say, for some quantum state transfer, which is something that I would like to investigate. So now here in the case where one has, we are going to consider that now we don't have even order hoppings. And now we are going to consider that we have just first order and third order hoppings. So when we have these two hoppings, then we have two pairs of H states, as I have told you. So one pair of H states in them, they are located, the spectral density, at the H's of the sample. And this second pair of H states, they are located in the third site and in the third site from the end, the weight of the H states. Okay, so now just summarizing, what we have is an array of quantum dots. Then we are going to assume that the hoppings decay exponentially with distance. And I want to comment as well that we have studied that with already eight atoms, so for dimers, one has yet very well defined H states and topological properties. So it goes in the direction that with the state of the art of the experiments, one could investigate, simulate with quantum dots this SSH Hamiltonian and this extended SSH Hamiltonian. So what we want, in fact, is to modulate spatially the hopping and to create this bone ordering as one has in the SSH Hamiltonian. We also want to imprint in our quantum dot array certain key symmetries, which provide from topological protection. And also we want to be able to tune and control the different long range hoppings. So for that, we are going to use this block engineering. So to apply a time periodic field. And that is the field that, or the term that we have considered in our Hamiltonian. We apply in each quantum dot locally different gates. And we are going to design these gates, the amplitude of these gates in order to remove the even order hops. And also we have this time dependent function, which is one in half of the period and minus one in the other half. Okay, now what we are going to do is to solve this Hamiltonian. So we are considering the high frequency regime. And then in the high frequency regime, one can obtain an effective Hamiltonian, which is time independent. And also, as we are working in the high frequency regime, one can do a expansion in terms of the inverse of the frequency, like a Magnus expansion. And then considering the first term of the expansion is enough to reproduce the dynamics or the properties of the system. So that is what we have done. And we have obtained an effective Hamiltonian, where here this R is the range of hoppings that we consider. And these are the hoppings of all order in principle. And then what is interesting is that this renormalization of the hoppings is a function which depends on the difference of the gates in the different quantum dots. And also it has this part of the function which has periodically spaced zeros, which are located when this condition is fulfilled. So then we are going to impose this condition to these even order hoppings in order to cancel them. So first we define our amplitudes in different gates in this way, so that we have this dimerized structure, alpha, beta, alpha, beta, and so on, the difference between the gates in neighbor dots. And once we have done that, what we do is to impose the condition that I have shown you in order to cancel the even order hopping. So we impose that for even order neighbors, then this condition is fulfilled, and then all the even order neighbors are renormalized to zero. Mm? So what do we have now? So what we have now is an array of quantum dots, which has a dimerized structure, which has first order neighbor, third, fifth, and all the odd order neighbors, and the even order neighbors are renormalized to zero. So what we are going to do next, okay, now what we do is to look at the topological invariant, their value as a function of different parameters. So here, what I show is that, as I said, we assume exponential decay of the hoppings with distance, and we consider the range of hoppings that we include, so those which fulfill this condition. So then if one look at the decay length and the amplitude divided by the frequency, it's an effective field amplitude, one can see here the topological invariant, the winding number in different colors. And you can see that if you have a large decay length, then, sorry, because a large decay length, then what you have is a large number of pairs of H states and of the topological invariant. So now I want to plot the quasi-energies of this spectrum as a function of the intensity, this effective intensity divided by the frequency of the field, of the external field. And we have considered a particular value of this lambda, this decay length, which is around 1.5. And then there we see that what we have is first and third order neighbors. So now we plot this quasi-energy spectrum, and then we see first a region for low intensities divided by the frequency where the topological phase invariant is zero. Then another region increasing the intensity divided by the frequency when we have the winding number is equal to one, and then we have one pair of H states. And increasing further the intensity divided by the frequency, then we see another region where we have two pairs of H states. And it is interesting that, okay, even if we cannot appreciate in the case where that where the winding number is one, we cannot appreciate the splitting of these levels. But here in the case where you have two pairs, you can see here in the inset that they split in a different manner. So they are going to give rise to different dynamics if we put up a particle, we load the particle in the in this H states, which is what we have done. So now what we have done is to consider a Hamiltonian where the same Hamiltonian I have shown you with this time-dependent term, and also we have included the Haber interaction, and we want to see which is the effect in the dynamics of two spins. So we are going to load one spin in the site one of the array, which is a spin up there, and then another spin in the third quantum dot, and we are going to allow the system to evolve, the particles to evolve. So first, we have considered this particular value of the intensity divided by the frequency. And then what we see here when we have a pair of H states is that the spin which was load in the first site oscillates, perform Rabi oscillation between the two H's because of this pair of H states which see each other and then form this, this pair of H states allow for the dynamics of this particle without coming in the bulk, because these states are decoupled with the bulk, from the bulk. And the second particle, however, spreads its dynamics within the bulk. I want to mention that also, I think that as we are always thinking how to detect these kind of things, that maybe if one put a charge detector, like for instance, a quantum dot in these closed systems, one could detect also these dynamics and one can learn from that the topological phase of your system. Now we switch on the interaction. In fact, this is a large interaction, the Haber interaction on site interaction. And then what we see here, if we plot the dynamics, is that now the H state become, the pair of H states become correlated with the bulk. And then it implies that the particle, the two, the dynamics of the two particles also are correlated, and is what we see here. Now the dynamics is not restricted to the H's, but also spread out in the bulk. Yeah. And then let us go what happens when we go to this other region where we have two pair of H states. So now, as I said, one of the second pair of H states is located in the third site and also in the third from the end, and is why we put the second particle in the third quantum dot. So what we see here is, in fact, these Rabi oscillations, as before, due to the first pair of H states. But also what we see here is that the second particle, the spin-down particle, performs also Rabi oscillations with much higher frequency due to the splitting, the difference of splitting between the third and the third from the end site. So now if we connect or switch on the interaction, now what we see is that, in fact, again, the two H states become correlated and then the dynamics of the two particles. But interestingly, and also, of course, the frequency of the dynamics is different, has changed, but the bulk does not participate at all in the dynamics of the particle. Okay, so I think that that is the most things I want to tell you, but okay, I want first to conclude telling that I think that semiconductor quantum dot networks are very good and suitable solid state platform for quantum state transfer and also for quantum simulations. I also want to say that flow engineering, in fact, is a very useful tool for these two purposes and for many others. Here in this work, summarizing, we have proposed an AC-driven protocol to simulate a dimer change in a quantum dot array with also long-range order hoppings. And it means that one could, if one could implement that in an array of quantum dots, then what one could see these effects, and it could be, I think, a very nice tool, and is, as I have said, with 8 quantum dots, it could be possible. And we have seen also that we also have shown that considering this extended SSH Hamiltonian, one has a new topological phases, which has been achieved by flow engineering. And we have studied their role in the dynamics. And then just I want to mention the outlook, what we are doing now. What we want to do is to study more in detail the effect of interaction also in the topology, something we didn't do yet in this system. And also one thing that we are doing now, we have recently finished a work on that, is to study if one could use, because as I mentioned before, we are always worried about the possibility to detect effects. And in this case, to detect the topology, I have shown you this, this work by Sigmund Koller on transport, where you can detect the topology by looking at the current and the sub noise. I have shown you that with a charge detector, maybe you can detect the topology, but also we wanted to see if one has a hybrid system, a quantum cavity, a superconducting cavity, and a topological system, one can detect the topological phases. So that is, I don't have time to come into details, but okay, we have seen that in fact we have analyzed different regimes of interaction considering input-output formalism plus mean field plus quantum fluctuations, and then we have seen that in fact different features appear when one is in the topological or one is in the trivial phase. So this is a CONMAT reference. And also I would like to mention that of course one could go to other topological models to investigate also this long range transfer and their properties. And that is a work that we are doing in collaboration with Juan Zurita, who is here, and also Charles Preflin, the Complutense. And I want to say that, okay, I am now looking that one can implement the dimer change, which is one dimensional array in quantum dots. But as we have seen that even one can implement two dimensional lattices, maybe if one has a good control of the Hoppings, one can implement other more complicated quasi one dimensional topological lattices in quantum dot semiconductor arrays. And okay, here we have investigated other systems, which are the Kreutz ladder lattice and the other ladders, which are called CSSH ladders, which has properties of the SSH Hamiltonian and also the Kreutz ladder Hamiltonian. And then, okay, one can really investigate the topological edge states in these systems, how to switch them on and off, modifying the different parameters. For instance, you can modify the Hoppings and then the topology change. Here in this lattice, you apply a magnetic flux, and then you can see the interplay between also topology and also localization. This is called Aronoff-Bohm gauging. So there are a lot of things to investigate, and there are many people in cold atoms working in these systems, but it could be also possible to bring these ideas to semiconductor quantum dots. And just to thank my co-workers in all this flock engineering the extended SSH Hamiltonian. The work has been done by Bea, Beatriz Pérez, Miguel Bello, who is now postdoc in Garching, and Álvaro Gómez León, who is now working in the Fundamental Physics Institute at the CSIC. And Bea is finishing her PhD here. Also, I want to acknowledge my other co-workers in different parts of the talk. First, David Fernández, who is studying these whole spin qubits and the transfer using these shortcuts to relativity techniques. I also want to thank the collaboration with the University of Bilbao, with Yuvan and Sichen. Yue was postdoc with us for a couple of years some time ago, and they are experts in these shortcuts to adiabaticity techniques, and we collaborate with them. I want to thank Jordi also, with whom I did also a recent work analyzing this charge noise and inducing these dynamical sweet spots, and who is now a postdoctoral research in Regensburg University. And I want to thank Juan and Charles also for these different new topological systems that we are investigating. And finally, I want to acknowledge Sigmund, with whom I have done many of these works and is an expert in flock theory, in quantum transport, and with whom we have the pleasure to collaborate every day. So that is all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this very nice talk. So Elsa Prada is at the other side of the screen. Elsa, do we have questions in the chat?
Hi. Well, we had a question that then by Ruth, who said that then it was answered, but I don't know if you want to comment a little bit more on that. And then another question. So a couple of them. I go to first to the last one.
Okay.
Fernando Domínguez, Hi, Gloria. Thanks for the very nice talk. One question concerning the chiral symmetry you have considered in the SSH. How robust are your results against the presence of disorder, spin orbit coupling, or other couplings that can naturally break the chiral symmetry?
Okay, you mentioned disorder. As I have mentioned before, first, in this system, we are not studying the implementation of spin orbit physics, because in this model it is not considered spin orbit physics. It is in others, but not in this. But concerning the disorder, as I have mentioned, if you have off diagonal disorders or disorder in the hoppings, then these states are protected. If you have not off diagonal but diagonal disorder, then you also destroy the topology, you destroy the chiral symmetry, and then that is also an issue, which in fact also can be an issue when you build up these systems, and then you have to align the levels and to control very well the gates. So I think that, okay, you require these conditions, and but in the hoppings, which is where they have most of the problems, if you have disorder, then your states are robust.
Thanks. And then if you want to comment something else on this previous question, how do high order neighbor hoppings contribute? What I mean is whether accounting for them changes qualitatively the results or just improves them quantitatively, and also what increases the strength of this higher order hopping.
Yeah, well, you know, I have mentioned first, as I have discussed before, if you have these odd order hoppings, in principle, the symmetries are conserved. And then what you have are additional topological phases with the even order hoppings not. But we have proposed a particular protocol, and where you can also tune, modifying the parameters, you can tune also the intensity. Here, for instance, we are increasing the intensity of a third order hopping against a second order hopping, which is closer, yeah, with these protocols. So there are not only these, but other protocols which will allow you, of course, to have, I think, also new interesting properties, because like that, it's like if you were changing also the lattice of your system, because you are enhancing this long range hopping against the shorter ones. And you can also, it is not the only protocol, you can also think on other protocols which you can implement. And I think that in this particular system, because in each different lattice is different, as I have mentioned, this Kreutz ladder or these other lattices, things are different. But in this SSH Hamiltonian, just as I said, the other order hoppings, they don't play any role then, but they increase the number of topological phases and then the number of pairs of H states. Mm-hmm. But for instance, with this protocol, we also look at certain time to trimers, which also have other different symmetries and properties, and we saw that we could also implement them. So I think that each lattice and each protocol has their own advantages and disadvantages. But mm-hmm. in this case, I think that that is the answer. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions here in the room?
Yeah, I have a question about, if possible, you can explain more about the relation between the noise and the topology. So the soft noise, do you differentiate between ballistic and diffusive transport?
Yeah.
Why there is also is also relation without electric field? And is there any experiment about that in polyacetylene?
No, I don't know experiments about that in polyacetylene. Just I put this particular example where we consider a particular system, which is just one particle, which is strongly interacting, so you don't allow for a second one coming. So that is quite a bit, difficult, I think, to achieve in a long array of quantum dots. But we apply an AC driving field, which is applied, and a DC also in order to induce the transport, and an AC field at the edges on the structure. So how we interpreted this is that when you have these H states is when the current goes close to zero, and in the soft noise you have a Poissonian-like behavior. You have now these electrons which drop in these H states, and they just tunnel, but it's not the, I would say, super Poissonian that you could see if you would study the propagation in the bulk. So that was that we observed in this particular case. So that is what we plot here. This is the soft noise, the value, the Fano factor. And then we saw that this Fano factor was around one when we had this, this topological H states in the system, which produced this behavior of the transport. But as I said, that is a particular experiment. And of course, it's a theory. I mean, it has not been done experimentally.
No, but the question is the model, the SSH, basically is the model for polyacetylene.
Yes.
So this is the reason of the model. So probably it's possible to make this experiment in polyacetylene.
I think so. I think so, because in fact, it's what okay we thought about that, even to do that, maybe also not with quantum dots, but with the molecule itself. Yeah. But unless I didn't see it, I don't know an experiment, but as you say, it could be done in molecules. That was the proposal, in fact.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? Elsa, do we have something else?
No here.
Okay, well, so then we thank Gloria again for this great talk. So you can clap so everyone can hear.
Thank you
everyone, and next week we will have another talk on Thursday. In this occasion it will be Adolfo del Campo from University of Luxembourg. He will talk about topological effects in a quantum annealer. So see you next week.